This is Fox 31 Now.
Good morning. You're watching Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. Colorado voters are going to have a new question on the ballot this November related to affordable housing. A group that's pushing for this initiative right now is discussing the details. Let's go ahead and listen in, and I'll break it all down after we're wrapped up here.
Of people's inability to afford to live in Colorado. Right now, what we know is more than 50% of Coloradans can no longer afford to live here. What that means particularly is the biggest driver of affordability in the state right now is housing. We use a metric on affordable housing that says if you are spending more than 30% of your income to either pay your rent or pay your mortgage, that means you are housing burdened. That means there's no way to pay the rest of the bills you have in your stack and make ends meet. Right now, a full 51% of Coloradans are paying more than 30% of their income to rent or mortgage. That means more than 50% of Coloradans can no longer afford to live here. There's a recent survey by the Colorado Health Foundation that showed that now 86% of Coloradans say this is a serious issue the state has to solve. And so that's why we're here today. If you look at what the challenges are, many people see it outside their own door or in their own paychecks, which are right now, costs of housing have gone up dramatically, 133% in the last several years, but many people's wages have not gone up. And so if we look at the trajectory we're on right now, it is unsustainable. We can't have a Colorado where teachers and nurses and firefighters can't afford to live in the communities that they serve. We can't afford a Colorado where Coloradans can't afford to live here. And so if you look right now at this trend, I have young kids, we were thinking, oh gosh, I hope 10, 15 years from now, they'll come back and want to live in Colorado again. Well, if the current trend for cost of housing continues over the next 10 years, and you have a 10 or 11, 12 year old, and you hope they'll come back and want to buy a home, if we keep going at this rate by 2032, a median family home in Colorado would cost $1.7 million. That means to be able to put a down payment on that home, you would have to make $339,000 a year for an income. If we keep going at this pace just to be a renter in this state in 10 years, you'd have to make $106,000 a year to afford a median rental unit anywhere in the state. Those are clearly unsustainable. And that is why we're here today, which is we are delighted to announce today that we are here having just submitted more than 220,000 signatures from Coloradans who want a different answer. They want to make Colorado affordable, and they want to make sure they can afford to live here and their kids can afford to live here. So we have introduced a ballot measure today called Make Colorado Affordable. That will be the first time Colorado voters have had the chance to weigh in on affordable housing. It's the most important issue facing the state and never been one they've had the chance to weigh in on. We know now they want to weigh in on it. And so here's what the measure does, is without raising taxes, this measure will create a $300 million a year affordable housing fund. That will be able to go to support workforce housing, to support home ownership, to support folks experiencing homelessness, the entire continuum of needs across affordable housing. And what it does is it dedicates one-tenth of 1% of the current income tax that is in the state budget to be able to go to affordable housing. At that point, local communities and nonprofits would have the chance to be able to draw down those funds to help meet the needs that exist in their local communities. And so we think this is critical. This would be a 5 times increase over what the state is currently spending on affordable housing, and it creates a permanent and sustainable revenue source that we know will be here year in and year out. So it's not some federal dollars and then be gone. We know we have about 170,000 units that will be permanently affordable that need to be built in Colorado for us to meet the need of folks that are here right now. This will leverage more than $6 billion over the next 2 decades that could build those 170,000 units we need to actually solve the problem that Coloradans are feeling right now in their pocketbooks. So we think this is a transformational opportunity to solve Colorado's biggest problem without increasing taxes, but with actually getting the resources we need to get the housing we have for people to be able to stay here. So you don't have to just take it from me. We want to let you hear from some of our business leaders, community leaders, teachers on the ground who are experiencing this in their own words. And so I'm going to introduce Rob Gartzman, who drove 150 miles all the way from Salida to tell you a little bit about how he, as a small business owner in Salida, is facing these challenges of affordable housing and what this measure can mean for him. Thanks so much for being here. Wow.
Hi, everyone. My name is Rob Gartzman. My wife and I moved to Salida 10 years ago with experience as chefs, one business degree between the two of us, and a whole lot of entrepreneurial spirit. We decided to invest everything we had in an underachieving bakery and deli. It was our first small business venture, as owners, and it turned out to be pretty successful. Sweetie's Sandwich Shop is now in its 10th year, and thanks to the support of our community, and apparently because we were bored, we've also been able to open two other restaurants during that time. Mo Burrito is still operating to this day, but we did eventually have to sell our fancy burrito restaurant. We also operate the Biker and the Baker, which is a brunch, cocktail, wine, and dessert bar that's located on the two floors above Sweetie's. We loved Mo Burrito, but it was a challenge to run three businesses in Salida. And those challenges will sound familiar to any business owner right now. We had a hard time trying to keep reliable help. And the struggle is directly tied to the fact that our workforces were struggling to find affordable housing. Clearly, I have a slight bias, but I do believe restaurants and bars are vital to our communities as gathering places and the foundation that form the foundation of our towns. It's definitely true in Salida. In the 1990s, the railroad left our town, and shortly after the Climax mine closed. Almost overnight, the two largest industries shipped out, and our town had no choice but to reinvent itself for the 5,000 residents that call it home. Residential property taxes were lowered to help the folks out in Salida, and Salida was rebranded as a tourist destination. In the process, both sales taxes and commercial property taxes were raised to keep things afloat. It's taken more than 20 years, but that bet has paid off. Recreation and tourism now account for more than 70% of our local economy in Chaffee County. But there's one thing. The folks who make it all work can't afford a place to live. You've got to pay $600,000 for a 1,200 square foot house, and $500,000 will get you a total dump. I've watched seven friends close major restaurants in the last 2 years, and I know of two more that are going to close soon. They're all directly tied to not being able to find enough help. The loss of our gathering spaces is one thing, but the loss of valuable commercial and sales tax that these businesses provide is another. How many times are we going to ask our small towns to reinvent themselves? How much longer are we going to ignore the problems facing rural Colorado? As a business owner, it's my job to hold my staff accountable when we have problems. But right now, small businesses in rural Colorado can't afford to do that because we can't afford to lose anyone. We need everyone that we have to stay on our staff. Our labor pool is incredibly small and there's no one else available. It's having a ripple effect across our state. We must address our housing crisis before it's too late for our small businesses in town. I believe this ballot measure gives us a real shot to do that, and I believe it does so in two ways. First and foremost, this measure gives local communities the power to solve this problem for themselves. It funnels money directly into governments who are actively working to solve this crisis for taxpayers, not just the ones who are paying lip service to the problem. Second, the measure will deliver mixed-income housing capable of serving our workforces and our disappearing middle class. We're not talking about handouts. We're not talking about creating more homes for out-of-towners to gobble up. We're talking about creating homes expressly meant for hard-working Coloradans. As a 20-year Coloradan and a Chaffee resident for the last 10 years, I know many other hard-working business owners who, just like my wife and I, have bootstrapped it and leveraged ourselves as much as we can to make a living in the place we love. And this housing crisis is threatening to destroy that. As Mike said, I drove up here because I'm passionate about this. But I'm done talking. It's time to get to work. And I'm proud to be up here today with a group that's ready to do just that. Now I'll pass the mic to Garfield Warren, a history teacher in Denver. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Garfield Warren, and I'm an AP U.S. history teacher at DSST, Green Valley Ranch. I'm here today to speak with you and to tell you about the thousands of hardworking teachers in Colorado who are being priced out of their communities we serve. Living in Colorado is more expensive than ever. Because of that, it is no surprise that 88% of Coloradans recently surveyed said the cost of housing is a huge concern. Over the last 50 years, wages in our state have stagnated, while home sales and rental costs have more than doubled, pricing many Coloradans out of places they call home. For folks like me, who hope to be able to have a home one day, the barrier is just too high right now to buy. The Keystone Policy Center will soon be releasing a comprehensive report on the dire impact our housing crisis is having on Coloradan educators. They shared with us a few hard truths for teachers in the metro area that I would like to share with you today. Only 14% of homes in the Denver Public Schools enrollment zone are affordable to teachers. In Jefferson County, only 10% of those homes are affordable to teachers, making a district average salary. And in Douglas County, that number is even smaller at 3% of homes are affordable for teachers. Currently, the average cost of homes in our state is more than $500,000, what makes it virtually impossible for the average Coloradan to afford. And the competition is fierce, like you guys all know. If prices continue to rise, as they have the past few years, teachers, nurses, firefighters, and many more will be priced out of our rental and housing markets, leaving many of us with nowhere to go, robbing our neighborhoods of essential services. I am renting now, but hopefully in the next year, I can buy a home. I do want to be a resource for my students here in Denver and a role model that actually lives and works inside the community. I want to be a staple in my neighborhood because you can't truly be connected to the citizens you serve unless you pay property taxes, pay sales taxes, and understand the issues facing communities. I want to let my students know that I'm invested in their future and I'm concerned about their future. When I attended the FNE Community Hub's regional planning meeting in Montbello, they talked about needing frontline workers inside the community because our neighbors are looking for us for support. Folks want to know across the street they can talk to the firemen about questions. Students want to know that Mr. Warren is in the neighborhood if they want to ask me questions about homework help, or questions about testing. I want more of our kids to see people like me, a veteran and a plumber, folks with stable jobs who are able to be successful. That helps our students feel like they can serve in the community and be successful within that community. But right now, Colorado's housing market is benefiting out-of-state investors much more than hardworking folks in our neighborhoods. Too many of our colleagues and I are forced to commute into areas where we work. As a result, we rob those areas of the opportunities to build deeper relationships with folks we serve. Kids are robbed of role models that they see outside and inside the classroom. And our communities are robbed of resources that they desperately need today. We can't solve those problems until we solve our housing crisis. That is why I believe we need a permanent solution that gives more Coloradans a shot and builds a home within a well-resourced communities. I support this ballot measure because it funnels existing revenue away from rich investors' pockets and puts it right back into the neighborhoods, where it can actually benefit the people and services that make them great. I am now excited to introduce a full history buff like myself, Brian Rosbert. He majored in history at Adams State, go Grizzlies, and he has been working, building community across Colorado for almost 15 years.
Thank you so much. My name is Brian Rosbert, and I'm the Executive Director of Housing Colorado. Our organization is dedicated to ensuring that communities across the state are affordable, healthy, vibrant, and safe. At Housing Colorado, we believe that the affordable housing crisis can only be solved if we work together to find a Colorado-based solution that addresses everything from homelessness to home ownership. Since our founding in 2005, we have seen the cost of living rise exponentially in Colorado. Those rising costs are reducing economic mobility for hardworking Coloradans and destabilizing our communities. More than half of Coloradans can't afford to live here any longer. Renters are a housing burden, and the average cost of a house is out of reach for those who want to buy a home. Something needs to be done. This measure that we're talking about today will provide a comprehensive solution to the housing crisis that is challenging homeowners, renters, and those who are unhoused. More so, this measure will bring the community together to solve the housing crisis so that future generations can look forward to a better tomorrow. We spend a great deal of our time at Housing Colorado traveling across the state to work with many different types of communities. And Rob's exactly right. It's impossible to have a conversation about any of the problems facing our state right now without talking about housing first. Community-driven needs must always drive the solutions to our housing crisis. For instance, the city of Craig recently conducted a housing needs assessment, and one of the solutions they highlighted was a need for smaller homes that first-time homeowners and seniors on fixed incomes could afford. And that's what I love about the solution at the heart of this ballot measure. It provides the right mix of funding and local controls to make that possible. This is a solution to our housing crisis that truly puts Coloradans first. Our current neighbors are the folks who underlay our community. They're our backbone, and they have to keep it strong. Speaking of backbones, there are a few organizations in Colorado that have a stronger one than Habitat for Humanity. And that's why I'm delighted to introduce to you Heather Lafferty, who's the incredible leader of the organization in Metro Denver, and she's been there for almost 15 years. Heather?
Well, good morning, everyone. I am really excited to be here this morning. At Habitat for Humanity, we believe that home ownership builds strength, stability, and independence for individuals while also creating stable, vibrant communities from which generations of families can thrive. But too many Coloradans are missing out on the opportunities that provides due to the rising cost of housing in our state. Every day at Habitat, we see how the spirit of creativity and teamwork occurs and comes to life when volunteers and advocates come together to ensure that members of our community can continue to call Colorado home. And if we're going to make Colorado affordable, we're all going to need to lean into that same spirit. And that's what makes this measure so remarkable. It's a chance for Coloradans to come together to build a permanent stream of funding that our communities, including families and friends, neighbors and employers, that we can all rely on to build our own version of prosperity now and for generations to come. We are particularly excited that this measure will dedicate funds to affordable home ownership opportunities so that Coloradans are able to have funding for more affordable rental as well as the wealth building opportunity of home ownership. At Habitat, we see when families own a home, it builds the foundation for a healthy, successful life. When children have a safe home, they are more likely to succeed in school. When individuals have predictable and affordable housing costs, they can release some of the day-to-day stressors and begin to plan for their future, building generational wealth over time. And when families have safe, peaceful homes, they experience better physical and mental health and overall better quality of life. So as I wrap up, this makes me think of Branda. She is a phlebotomist in the ICU at CU Medical Center at the Anschutz campus. She takes care of an aging uncle along with her young son. Since buying their affordable home, her son is on the honor roll and has been able to join the track team. And Branda herself has gone on to start working full-time, is taking classes at Arapahoe Community College. She has taken on a student leadership role with student government, and she is also a state representative. Branda and her family are thriving. The transformative power of home cannot be understated. And while Habitat believes that people deserve to have a decent and affordable place to live so that Branda and all families can make their families' dreams come true. And that's why Habitat leaders and volunteers across the state are supporting Make Colorado Affordable. Through the collective dedication of people here today and so many others who have signed their support for this measure, we can create sustainable housing solutions for more people in communities across our state. So thank you. And now I'll go ahead and turn things back to Mike to wrap us up.
Thank you so much. I think you've heard from an incredibly diverse coalition of people from all parts of the state, all industries, all backgrounds, who feel the same way that 88% of all Coloradans feel, which is it's time for this state to take action to make Colorado affordable. And this offers voters the first chance for them to weigh in on a plan that can actually deliver the units we need and the homes we deserve for the families who are trying to work and live and build our communities. And so we think this is a historic chance for Colorado to lead the country as the first state to adopt a comprehensive approach like this. And I think it will be great for Colorado residents and all parts of the state. So with that, I'll stop, and we're happy to take questions if you all have them on any parts of the policy or the coalition or things you might have heard of. And I would give the floor to you if there are questions.
Yeah, you explain, so I get it, just raise taxes. You explain, like, does it take $300 million from potential
paper
refund checks?
Sure, so what it does, it's two steps, is it dedicates 0.1% of the current income tax, which is in the general fund, to affordable housing. So it pulls that $300 million out of the general fund. By the voters approving the use of that, that debruces that $300 million, which means that doesn't count towards the Tabor cap anymore. So there's now $300 million more space in the budget that allows $300 million of what could be refunds to drop into the general fund, so the general fund stays whole. So it allows you to fund affordable housing without increasing taxes in a way that's is a permanent revenue stream.
So
the answer is it comes out of the general fund, but it allows the what would be refunds to backfill the general fund. It does not come directly from tax refunds.
It comes indirectly.
Correct. Yeah.
Have you anticipated some of the opposition arguments? Was the anti-tax group, I can't remember the exact name, but they just sent out an email 10 minutes ago opposing this initiative. So what are some of the arguments that you anticipate hearing?
I mean, we're really excited right now that we have a very broad coalition in support. There's not a formed coalition opposed to it that we know of. I'm sure there will be individuals who feel that way. I think the reason why is really, you know, whether you are a business owner, whether you are a teacher, whether you are a nurse, everyone has a need in either having a place to stay or having an employee that needs a place to stay. So we think there's a real broad-based support of it. We think that the fact that it doesn't increase taxes is a real benefit. And so I think that people want a solution to this problem, like the revenue stream, and in a state where there's, you know, $3 billion of surpluses projected, you could see dramatic changes in the economy that still wouldn't touch this revenue stream. So I think it's a rare opportunity to solve the biggest problem the state faces without increasing taxes in a way that's stable. So I think that's why we've seen as much support for this measure as we have, and as much interest from the voters across the state as we've seen. Great question. So what this does is any of these new units, when they're built, they're required to be permanently affordable. So they're what's called deed restricted to be permanently affordable. So that unit, when it's approved, has to require that whoever lives in there doesn't pay more than 30% of their income to rent. And so it is a way of making sure those units that are rentals stay affordable permanently, even if the market increases. So it does not put in place rent control, but what it does do is build units that are restricted to only be affordable for people. Does that make sense?
And or what about, like, how you say apartments or renters, instead of increasing my rent every month by $400, is there a way to control the rents?
Yes. So what these units would do is the rent would never go higher than whatever 30% of your income is. So these units would be required to cost no more than 30% of your income. So if folks were making $50,000 a year, they can't be paying more than $15,000 a year in rent. And so if you're paying $1,100 a month, it can't go up from that $1,100 as long as that's what you're making. So it makes sure that rents don't keep going up when your wages aren't going up.
How would you spend it around those things? Certain cities are going to get more of these than, say, like Salida area or something. They're going to go to Denver. How do you make sure it's even?
Yeah, so these funds will be administered by by two different entities in the state. Likely one will be Division of Housing, the other would likely be an entity like CHAFA. What would happen is cities or counties or nonprofits would apply when they had a project where they wanted to build affordable units, they would apply for these dollars. There's a requirement that include geographic diversity, that it includes all parts of the state, that it includes being mindful of environmental sustainability, that it includes mixed income development, so you're keeping a combination of different incomes in a building. And so they would apply project by project for that funding. And there are two things that we ask local governments to do to access the funding. One is that they have a process to put affordable housing projects at the front of the line in the review, that there's a prioritized review for affordable housing projects so it doesn't take 2 years to get them approved. That's a big part of the challenge right now. The second is that we ask communities to commit to setting a goal to expand their stock of affordable housing by 3% a year each year. And so if you have 1,000 affordable units in Salida right now, you got to build 30 new units next year. And that provides an incentive for those local governments to make sure they're prioritizing the approval of affordable housing and that we're steadily increasing the amount. And every one of those new units that comes on will be guaranteed to be affordable to folks that are renting and not see massive increases in the cost each year. Great question. Other questions?
There's only one more, and I don't know.
Please.
But the series art wants to build affordable housing, but the city or some I heard doesn't want to approve that. So how do you overcome the areas that they need affordable housing that the local government doesn't want to build?
We view this as a carrot to help support local governments that are trying to build affordable housing. And so what this would mean is this $300 million pot of money you have access to as a city or a county if you are committing to build affordable housing. If you are going to resist the construction of that affordable housing and you don't permit those units, you'd not be able to access these funds. And so we provide an incentive here to say we believe most communities really want more affordable housing. We know 88% of Coloradans do. And so this is an incentive for those county commissioners or city councilwomen or others to say, we know that we can get access to these funds to help us build affordable housing if we set a goal to increase our stock by 3% each year, and if we put these affordable housing projects at the front of the line for approval. So we think we give them flexibility on how and where they want to build those, but they need to commit to doing that if they want to get access to the dollars, and we think that incentive, rather than a mandate, is the better way to go. Any other questions? Okay, great. Well, a huge thank you so much for coming. We appreciate all your time you spent to be here. And we think this is really a monumental moment for Colorado to take a step forward into solving what is our biggest crisis and just making sure that we can make Colorado affordable for all the Coloradans who are trying to make this great state to live. So thank you so much for being here.
And thank you, folks, for tuning into Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. A lot to unpack and a lot of new information that is just coming into our newsroom about this ballot initiative. And so, again, they've collected more than 220,000 signatures, so they're about 100,000 signatures more than what they need to make that threshold for the November ballot. But just to spell out how this thing would work, essentially, you would take 0.1% of the state's income tax revenue and set that aside from the general fund where it would normally go to a specific fund for affordable housing. So that would be not an increase in taxes, it's just taking the tax money the state is already generating and putting it in a separate pot other than the general fund. And so that mechanism in particular, again, we're still learning about this thing, but obviously we have the Taxpayer Bill of Rights, or TABOR, basically meaning that the state can't spend more than it brings in. And so it sounds like they're trying to work around that mechanism. It's not a new tax per se, but that wouldn't be taking funds away from the general fund directly for this. It would actually be pulling it into a separate pot. So it's an interesting funding mechanism for sure. Again, obviously the voters are going to decide when this thing comes out on the ballot. And so when we're talking about affordability, and a lot of people have questions about this, Marty, for example, saying, and again, let's see if the graphics work today. I'm not sure if they're going to, but if not, There's Marty. Just make sure they're actually affordable. Don't just label it as affordable. It's a good question and a good point in general. And so what does affordable really mean? And so it sounds like, at least when we're talking about the units for rent that would be built as a result of this money, they would be capped. The units are deed restricted if this thing goes through, and they would be capped where renters wouldn't pay more than 30% of their income. So that way, if your income is stagnant, your rent isn't going to increase by 100 or 200 bucks a month like we're seeing right now in the Denver metro with rent prices skyrocketing. And so there's a lot of information on this, right? And we have a full write-up on our website, kdvr.com, and the Fox 31 app. So far, again, we're looking to see more perspectives on this because it would be taking some tax money aside. And so we're curious and we're asking the questions of, are there any lawmakers who are opposed to this? Maybe this caps the amount of money they could spend on other things. But at the same time, and it was mentioned several times in that press conference, the affordability of this state is top of mind for Coloradans. We've done reporting on that, how 86% of people surveyed in a new poll say the affordability and the cost of living and the cost of housing is top of mind and the number one issue this state faces. Of course, if there is any opposition to this ballot initiative, we will include that perspective on our story at kdvr.com and the Fox 31 app. That's going to do it for me here on Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. Thank you so much for tuning in, and I'll see you next time.